Welcome back to Manga Melt. I'm your host, Jesse, and today we got DJ Spooky in the studio. You might recognize him from his app, DJ Spooky, his book, The Imaginary App, and even his album, Rhythm Warfare. DJ Spooky, thank you very much for coming by.
It's always a pleasure to check in with the YouTube world.
Now, please, tell us a little bit that you want to talk about the meaning of manga. You spent a lot of time in Japan. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
If you look at the root term manga, it translates into English as kind of a whimsical series of images. So the earlier ones were based on traditions of wood block cuts, and artists were really intent on showing a certain kind of unreality. So like ghosts, phantoms, Shinto spirits, stuff like that. After World War II and the US occupation, manga really changed because it became part of this sort of new vocabulary of people going to the office and they'd be reading it on the train, or you know, comic books from the US had come in and influenced stuff. So by the time you fast forward to 2015, you're seeing animation as inheriting all these different traditions of more like the earlier stuff that one could argue. You say, for example, why all the characters have the big eyes and stuff like that, exaggerated facial features. That's coming out of their own traditions. And then on the other hand, the idea of layout and design, that's coming out of a sort of a remix of American comic books. So I love the fact that it's this kind of global response to thinking about cartoons, thinking about, you know, strange, fantastical, kind of totally bizarre realms. And some of my favorite ones are stuff like that are all set in the near future.
Oh, yeah, no, that's perfect. That's all great. Because especially from there, we built on to be adapted to anime, a lot of more like even live action films. Mm-hmm. The translation sometimes doesn't quite work of those wacky faces to live action. Mm-hmm. But now, like, you know, are there any animes you're watching? Like, do you have any favorite animes or manga you like talk about?
Yeah, no holds barred. My absolute favorite is Ghost in the Shell by Mamoru Oshii that came out in the mid-90s. And amusingly enough, if you think about The Matrix, if you think about any of the kind of films that are showing like near future dystopia and like tech and stuff like that, interestingly enough, Ghost in the Shell is all about interior narrative. So if you look at like what happened with Christopher Nolan, who's one of my favorite directors, a lot of people are trying to figure out like films like Inception or films like The Matrix with the Wachowski brothers, but they're still responding to manga. And there's an incredible American, we're appropriating a lot of what's been going on in Asia. So the action sequences in The Matrix, the incredible fight scenes, those, you know, Wu-Tang Clan, for example, all of those guys are looking at what's going on in mostly Far East Asia, comics, film, kitsch films, and Quentin Tarantino, stuff like that. They're all kind of reprocessing that stuff.
Yeah, well, speaking of a lot of like, you know, the Wachowskis, Nolan, how are your feelings on the live-action adaptation of Ghost in the Shell with Scarlett Johansson as the Major? A lot of stuff about this one.
That one, you know, there's a long tradition in America of appropriation. I'm a DJ and I remix stuff, so I'm down with remix. But let's go back a little bit earlier. In the 1910s and 20s, when American cinema was first starting, they wouldn't have black people that much in the film, and they also wouldn't have Asian people. So they would call it blackface, and if an Asian person was playing, they'd call it yellowface. So a white guy would like just sort of put yellowface makeup on, and they wouldn't have an Asian character at all. They'd have a white guy or white woman playing the Asian.
Oh yeah, good old Mickey Rooney.
Yeah,
our
exactly.
Favorite.
Breakfast at Tiffany's update. So you have to imagine, it's 2015. There's plenty of Asian characters with star power. I mean, actors who could fill, you know. So Scarlett Johansson, I think, is cool. It's interesting. What I would do if I was the director is play off of the whole Asian action thing in a way that would really look at the stuff that happened in the House of Flying Daggers. You know, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Hidden.
Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that was wildly popular. And people would, if there was a cool Asian update of like Matrix, action films, tech, people would be into it. I don't see why they have to go for a Western. They had a corporate meeting and some executives made a bad decision. You know?
Oh, yeah. Well, because we even have Pacific Rim, Riko Kikuchi, an actual Japanese actress, one of the main characters in that film, and kills it.
Yeah.
Like, why not bring her along?
Right, sure. There's plenty of opposites. I think Americans are spoon-fed global culture, and I go and DJ in Japan, and I've worked with a lot of Japanese artists like Ryuichi Sakamoto, DJ Crush, all sorts of folks who are really very solid in the culture there. And you're like, come on, people. Americans need to see some cool global stuff, not just, you know, the next, you know, Tom Cruise is the Last Samurai or something. So I just wish they could just, you know, maybe they could do two versions where there'll be like the fan edit.
Yeah.
You know, you can just remix in the main character as the original anime, just make a hologram out of her or something and put her in the film. But Scarlett Johansson is pretty hot. I like her, you know, but it just, it's 2015. Let's get some more Asian. I think it's cool to have a lead character who's related to that culture, and we don't have to see an American bland version of it, you know?
Oh yeah, like why whitewash it?
Yeah.
No, I'm so glad to hear you say that. Is there a way that this has influenced some of your work, like your feelings towards this, like your time in Japan? And
oh, sure. DJ culture-wise, it's interesting. The Japanese and the Koreans have an incredible breakdancing scene, which comes out of martial arts, too, and they've been having a tremendous amount of impact in Korea with breakdancing, and the Japanese and Koreans have issues because of the war and occupation, and, you know, Asia, you know, it's kind of like, you know, they're all cousins, so that's when it's, like, really intense. But at the end of the day, the beauty of martial arts and the way that it's influenced hip-hop, especially, of course, Wu-Tang Clan.
Oh, yeah.
But the Chinese and the Japanese also have had a long history of issues and so on because of occupation, war, stuff like that. So the tensions between those three cultures, for me as a DJ, is really interesting. So sampling, DJing, remixing, that all is when cultures are like uncertain and you're kind of throwing all the stuff in the air and being able to pull bits and pieces. So yeah, my work is influenced, I'd say, above all by Ghost in the Shell. I mean, a classic, absolute brilliant film. They're doing a new update of that called Arise that Cornelius, who's an electronic music guy, has done a great new score for. And there's got to be some updates that I think people have to remember we are appropriating from them, you know. So I think when you look at hip-hop, techno, dubstep, any of these kind of styles, half of the drum machines were made in Japan, you know, all the early 808 drum machines and MPC, Casio, Yamaha, they're all Japanese.
Oh, you know. Well, you know, America loves to reappropriate a lot of, you can check Tumblr out and hear a lot more about that.
Mm-hmm.
Now tell me a bit about your app.
Okay. As a DJ for many years, I carried vinyl around. I'm kind of a vinyl collector, but at the same time, I'm somebody that's really deep into tech from a conceptual point of view. I'm not a code programmer, although I would love to one day when I have time. I also want to learn Mandarin if I ever can make enough time. But basically, I felt that in the last maybe 5 years or so, there was a transition out of vinyl. Some people are purists, I'm not. And I felt like, look, let's roll with the tech and see what happens. So people are going to be DJing from their phone, people are going to be DJing from their tablets, they'll even be DJing from their smartwatches. But the basic idea is that all of this is showing that the tablets and the cell phones now have enough processor speed. And same with cameras as well. Your cell phone now has a 16 megapixel camera. It's incredible, high 4K resolution. Same with sound. You have high resolution files. I can control all the videos while I'm DJing. So my iPad app, we're now up to about 14, maybe 15 million downloads.
Congratulations.
It's been free. It's adding a lot of zeros to my bank account. but at the end of the day, I'm into free culture and free software. So we made it free, and it's a tool like Dropbox, Evernote, whatever. Anything that you have on your iPad and from whatever format, Spotify, SoundCloud, Google Music, iTunes, you can just pull it into the app and start DJing. So I felt that half the battle is the interface, you know, giving people tools that are exactly like the turntables and the mixing board. And we got copied immediately, which is, that's the global way. So we're now up to about 15 million and going, and it's been fun to see how DJing is not just for someone who's an avid record collector, but my mom, you know, your mom, somebody's mom's DJing, you know, why not?
And just, would you be able to give us an example of your app?
Sure. All right, so say for example, here we go. I'm going to call up the app. It's called DJ Spooky, and the generic one is called DJ Mixer. So for example, I'm DJing a big party, and I forgot, I don't have my James Brown tracks on me. It's online if you have 4G connection, or you can have it instrumental, you know, in the actual tracks on the iTunes. So I just, you know, let's give it some volume. So
Can you show the camera for that?
Sure. So what I've done is automatically breaks the track up into edit points. So I'm going to put in some scratches and pull up another remix I've done of James Brown. So for example, yeah. So if I want to make a loop, you know. you know. So it's exactly like turntables, and we programmed in the latency and other things for scratching, for loops. You have echoes, effects. If you want to have one turntable, you can easily do it in a way that you can have two iPads so that you have two, like the equivalent of two turntables. And if you hold it that way, you got two turntables. So you can actually have up to four turntables if you have two iPads or more. So you can be streaming and mixing like a whole bunch. And the funny thing is, your average turntable, Technics 1200 or any of the really high-end ones, are going to cost several hundred dollars. But instead, you just get an iPad that can be any instrument. So I also can mix this with other apps. So say, for example, I'm going to call up a friend of my Cupmaster, Kurt. You know, and that's a beat, and I want to, why not dub, you know, do a...
And it runs in the background?
You know, so that means you can mix not only just with your turntables, but you can mix with other apps. So you're not just DJing music, but you're DJing with other apps. And if you think about how many sound apps there are right now and different forms of editing tools and stuff like that, it's explosive. I mean, and there's been zillions and zillions of apps right now. And so I wrote a whole book about this with MIT called The Imaginary App. And I wanted to give people some, you know, what I call thought tools for thinking about the role of mobile media and changing the way we design, draw, you know, make sound, and make film, and you know, so on and so on. So yeah, the book MIT just came out.
Awesome. No, that's great. We have a lot of DJ fans as well. I get a lot of messages from people such as Retro Senpai, DJ Jeeper, and Cherokee, who I think are going to love this kind of app. Mm-hmm. We're definitely going to check the description below. We're going to put a link to it so people can download it. Is there anything else you'd like to plug before we wrap up?
Yeah. Also, I'm the editor of a magazine with my partner. Her name's Miranda Pleasant, and we are doing this magazine. We're at every Whole Foods in the U.S. and Canada, and that's about food, art, music, and yoga, because I think half the battle these days is getting people to think a little bit more about the food they're eating. And yeah. I'm into what I call social justice and food justice issues, how we think of like health, because right now your average American is eating a terrible diet. You're sitting in a chair, you're driving a car. These are deeply unhealthy issues that are affecting lifespan. And I want to see a lot of creatives live longer, you know? So as an artist, I was like, you know what? There's no art magazine dealing with food and art, so we just decided to do it. And now we're up to about 400,000 an issue, and it's been, if you look on Facebook, Twitter, we have hundreds of thousands of people following the magazine. And it's an artist-run magazine with a couple people doing it. It's still fun, but yeah, the app and the magazine, those are side projects that kind of got bigger than I was expecting, but you know, it's 21st century, why not?
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for coming by.
All right.
Thank you so much for watching. Make sure to comment, rate, subscribe, give a download to that app, and make sure you can watch on Wednesday. We're going to have Mary Screw Kill with Mr. DJ Spooky. So make sure to check that out. Thank you so much.